In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, one God, Amen. Tonight, through the grace of God, we will study together chapter 4 from the letter of St. Paul to the Colossians. St. Paul actually concluded chapter 3 by giving instructions to different groups of people. He gave instruction to wives, to husbands, to children, to parents, and to bond servants. So, chapter 4, he continues his instruction, and he started with giving instruction to the masters. And after this, he spoke about the importance of prayer and also the importance of keeping proper conduct before those who are not believers. How we should behave with the non-believers. Then he concluded this chapter, which is the last chapter of this letter, by his final greetings. He started, as I told you, the first verse is about instruction to masters. And as I said before, Christianity doesn't encourage slavery. Christianity doesn't encourage or approve at all slavery. But Christianity is dealing with the situation. In the Roman Empire, slavery was approved. And the people were divided into masters and bond servants. So St. Paul is dealing with a situation that's already there. And masters at that time, they used to deal very, very harshly with the bond servants. Actually, they used to consider them as a property. And the law gave them the authority over their servants. For example, if any master killed or tortured his servant, nobody would question him. Nobody would hold him accountable. So St. Paul is dealing with a situation that's already there. That's why in dealing with the masters, he gives them four important instructions. The first instruction, to deal them with equality. He is telling them, although the system in the Roman Empire says that servants or bond servants are second class people, they are like properties, and you have authority over your slave to do with him whatever you want to do, to torture him, to abuse him, even to kill him, and nobody will question you why you are doing this. But St. Paul is saying, no, no, they are your brothers. Deal them with equality. Also, he is asking them to deal them as a human being, to consider their humanity. They have feelings. They will suffer from the injustice and the unfairness. So when you deal with your servant, don't deal with him harshly, but deal with him in a human way. And the third instruction is to be just and fair to them. To be just and fair to them. For example, if they did something good, you should compliment them, you should reward them, you should praise them. And if they did something wrong, you shouldn't be harsh in their punishment. Yes, you can discipline them, you can hold them accountable, but with fairness and with justice. And the fourth point, St. Paul is telling the masters to keep in mind that they are also bond servant to the heavenly masters. So, if I am a master right now, I should understand that I am also a servant to God. So, if with the same measure I deal with the servants, with the same measure God will deal with me. That's why I should remind myself all the time that I have heavenly master. And because of this, I should be kind, I should be fair, I should be merciful. Because with the same measure I am dealing with the bond servants, God will deal with me. You may say, but now there is no slavery. So how can we benefit from this verse in our life? Actually, although there is no slavery, but this verse you can apply it if you are in place of authority. For example, if you are boss in your job and you have people working under you, don't deal with them harshly. Don't deal them with unfairness or with injustice. Know that with the same measure that you use in dealing with them, God will use the same measure in dealing with you. And understand that not because they are under your authority, they are lesser than you. You should understand you and him are equal. So, if you are in a position of authority, please remember that God gave you this authority not to rule over, but actually to serve with love, kindness, merciful, to be merciful, to be just, and to be fair. So that's actually the first verse. St. Paul said, masters, give your bond servants what is just and fair, knowing that you also have a master in heaven. Masters, give your bond servants what is just and fair, knowing that you also have a master in heaven. So he reminded them that they are equal, that they should treat them as human beings, not as properties, to be just and fair to them, and also to keep in mind that they have a heavenly master in heaven ruling over them. After this, from verse 2 to 4, he spoke about prayer. Prayer. Let's read these verses. Continue earnestly in prayer, being vigilant in it with thanksgiving. Meanwhile, praying also for us, that God would open to us a door for the word, to speak the mystery of Christ, for which I am also in chains, that I may make it manifest as I ought to speak. Actually, St. Paul spoke here about six important elements in prayer. When he said continue means what? To be consistent in your prayer. Many times we just pray for 2 days or 3 days, and then we stop praying for 10 days, then we pray for 2 days, and then we stop praying for 3 days. We are not consistent. actually this inconsistency weakens our prayer. If you want to benefit from the prayer, and if you want to grow in the life of prayer, the first advice here, to be consistent. To be consistent. And actually this is the same instruction that our Lord Jesus Christ gave to us. To pray without ceasing. What does it mean to pray without ceasing? To be consistent. The second advice, St. Paul, he said earnestly. What does it mean to pray earnestly? To pray with passion. Some people, they just say the words of prayer. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom. Just they utter, their mouth utter the words. But their hearts have no passion with the prayer. So St. Paul is saying, do you want to benefit from your prayer? Do you want your prayer to be heard in heaven? Then you need to continue earnestly with passion. Number three, to be vigilant in your prayer. Continue earnest in prayer, being vigilant in it. What does it mean to be vigilant? To pay attention, not to be distracted. Many people complain about distractions in prayer. And then people say, you know, after I finish some prayer in the Agbaya, I stop and ask myself, did I say Holy God, Holy Mighty or not? Did I say Hail to you or I didn't say it? So he's just reciting prayers, but actually he's not watchful. He's not paying attention. He's not vigilant. So these are three important elements together. Pay attention means with no distraction. Continue means to be persistent and consistent in your prayer. And earnestly to pray with passion. So these are three important elements in prayer. How to pray consistently, and how to pay attention, to be vigilant, to eliminate as much as you can any distractions, and number three, to pray with passion. To pray with passion. Many times when we sing a song in the church before like meeting, people don't participate, and when they even sing, they don't sing with passion. You know, when you praise the Lord, you need to praise the Lord with all your senses, with all your power, with all your passion. I think in the Psali of Monday, we say, تجمعي فيا يا كل حواسي لأبارك اسم ربنا يسوع المسيح. So actually, in this Psali, I am calling all my senses to be gathered together in order to bless the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. That's how to pray with passion, consistently with passion, and also to be vigilant in it without being distracted. Number four, with thanksgiving. With thanksgiving. As Mar Isaac the Syrian said, there is no gift without increase except the one without thanksgiving. The church is teaching us to give thanks to God for every condition, in every condition, and upon every condition. And the Lord Jesus Christ instructed us to give thanks always. To give thanks always. So every time when we pray, we start with thanksgiving. Even in the church, in funerals, the first prayer in the funeral is, you know, thanksgiving. In the unction of the sick, we give thanks to God. Why we give thanks always? Because we trust His will, we trust His plan for us, we trust that whatever He chooses for us is for our benefit. And because of this, we give thanks to Him always, all the time. Number five, he said, when you pray, yes, you pray for yourself, but also don't pray for others. Don't forget to pray for others. Do not forget to pray for others. That's why he said, meanwhile, praying also for us. When we pray for others, as if we are putting others' interest before my own interest. And this is very precious before God. This is the real love. When I put others before myself. Because as we read in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, love doesn't seek its own. So when we pray others before ourselves, God actually appreciates this kind of prayer very, very much. And when we speak about others, which group that we should pray most of the time or all of the time for them? It is a group of the servants. Those who are serving the gospel of Christ. That's why when we pray in the litanies, we pray for our patriarchs, for our bishops, for our priests, for the deacons, for the servants, for all the ranks of the church. Why? Because they preach the gospel of Christ, and definitely they need assistance in their ministry. It's like Joshua, who was in war against Amalek, and Moses on the mountain praying for him. And whenever Moses raised his hands, actually Joshua was winning the war. And when Moses stopped praying, actually Joshua lost the war. Maybe you are not a Sunday school servant. Maybe you don't have a certain ministry in the church. Maybe you don't preach the word of God. But actually, there is something that each one of you can do. You can pray for the servants. You can pray for those who are preaching the word of God, preaching the gospel of Christ. This is very, very important. That's why St. Paul told them, meanwhile, pray also for us. For what? When we pray for the servants, pray for what? Actually, mainly, definitely we pray for every aspect of the church, but or ministry. But what is the goal of the ministry? The goal of the ministry is to preach Christ, is to preach the word of Christ, to preach the gospel. And this goal, we should not be distracted. We should be focused all the time on this goal. The ministry, the main ministry of the church is to preach Christ to everybody. That's our goal. That's our focus. That's why St. Paul spoke that you need to pray for the word of God, for the gospel of Christ. And by the way, some deacon in the litany of the gospel, they changed the response of the deacon. Instead of saying, pray for the holy gospel, they say, pray for the spread of the holy gospel. Actually, we will see now, when we say pray for the spread of the Holy Gospel, actually we are praying for one element. But there are many, many elements we pray for, not only for its spread. That's why it's better to say it as it is written in the liturgy book, pray for the Holy Gospel. Because as St. Paul explained to us, when we say pray for the Holy Gospel, we are praying for many, many things, not only for spreading the Holy Gospel. For example, when we say pray for the gospel, Holy Gospel, we are praying that the Lord may open the doors, may open the doors. Who will prepare the people and who will open the doors before the servants of Christ to go and preach? It's God. So we are praying that God may open the doors to preach the gospel. Also, we are praying that the servant, when they preach, they don't preach their own gospel. They don't preach from their own experience, but to utter the mystery of Christ. To utter the mystery of Christ. What is the mystery of Christ? St. Paul actually use this term, the mystery of Christ, in his letter to the Ephesians and also to Colossians. The mystery of Christ actually is the mystery of love. How God loved us and how God reconciled us with him and reconciled the Gentiles with the Jews. That's the mystery of Christ. How God now, not only Israel are his people, but whoever believe in him and accept him, God give them authority to be children of God, who are not born according to the flesh or according to the will of man or according to the blood, but they are born from God. That's the mystery of Christ. So we pray that God may open the door. We pray that when we preach, we don't preach ourselves or we don't deviate from the goal, but we preach the mystery of Christ to reveal God's love for every person. And the third point, to manifest it in the proper way. Because sometimes when we speak through filters and we don't present it in the right way. Like many people interpret the Bible differently. And when they present it, they manifest the mystery of Christ, they manifest it in the wrong way. So yes, they are preaching the mystery of Christ, but they are preaching it in the wrong way. For example, if I'm preaching, there is no need for baptism, there is no need for communion, there is no need for confession, there is no need for this in order to be saved. Although I am preaching the mystery of Christ, but I'm preaching it in the wrong way. That's why St. Paul is saying, pray that we may preach the mystery of Christ and present it and make it manifest in the proper way. Listen to what he said. Pray also for us that God would open to us a door for the word to speak the mystery of Christ, for whom I am also in chains, that I may make it manifest as I ought to speak. As I ought to speak means what? In order to make it manifest in the proper way, as I ought to speak, as God wants me to preach it, not as I understand it or as I want to preach it. Big, big difference. If I preach the mystery of Christ as I want to preach it or as Christ wants me to preach it, as I ought to speak. And also, we need to pray for the servants, because with serving God there is a cross. Usually there is a cross, there is suffering. In Joshua son of Sirach, in his book chapter 2 verse 1, we read, my son, if you presented yourself to serve the Lord, prepare yourself for many afflictions and hardships. That's why St. Paul told them, for which I am also now in chains. I am writing this letter to you while I'm in chains. I'm in prison. So pray for us that God may give us patience and strength to endure the suffering and to carry our cross joyfully without losing hope or without falling into despair. So these are six elements that St. Paul mentioned in prayer. Number one, to be consistent in your prayer. Number two, to pray with passion. Number three, without distraction, be vigilant in it. Number four, with thanksgiving. Number five, to pray for others, especially for the servants of the gospel, especially that they may endure their cross and carry their cross joyfully without falling into despair or without being discouraged. And number six, to pray for the gospel of Christ, that the Lord may open the door in order to preach the mystery of Christ, but how to preach it as we ought to, in the proper way. So these are six elements. I hope that we start exercising and training ourselves to keep these six elements whenever we pray, whenever we pray. Then after this, from verse 5, St. Paul spoke about how to keep proper conduct before others. How to keep proper conduct before others, especially before the unbelievers. How to deal with the non-Christians or those who are not member in the church. St. Paul called them those who are from outside. Those from who are outside. And actually, St. Paul gave us 5 points, important points, how to deal with those from outside. Let's read verse 5 and 6. He said, walk in wisdom toward those who are outside, redeeming the time. Let your speech always be with grace, seasoned with salt, that you may know how you ought to answer each one. That you may know how you ought to answer each one. So, how to deal with those from outside, the non-believers or the non-Christian, or those who are not members of the church? Number one, we need to deal with them wisely. Walk in wisdom toward those who are outside. Many times when we hear, for example, about incidents in Egypt or incidents against Christians, we get excited and start to react unwisely, react passionately but unwisely. This is not the right way. When you react, you need to think, number one, is this the wise reaction or not? Is this according to the will of God or not? And when we speak about wisely here, we are speaking about the heavenly wisdom, not the earthly wisdom. And one of the major characteristics of the heavenly wisdom, as St. James described it to us, it is peaceable. Peaceable. Musalima. So, St. Paul now is telling us to walk wisely. Let's examine. Every time we react, are we reacting wisely or not? This is a very important question. Walk in wisdom toward those who are outside. I'm sure all of you know the miracle of moving al-Mu'attam. But do you know how this miracle started? Let me tell you the story behind it. The Khalifa had a Jewish minister. Then he called one of the religious leaders, Christian leaders, in order to debate with the Jewish minister. So when they started the debate, the Christian leader said to the Khalifa, how do you want me to debate with those who were described worse than the describe it like they are worse than the animals? Definitely the Jewish minister was very, very offended by this. But this Christian leader told him, didn't Isaiah said in chapter 1, God spoke in the prophets of Isaiah chapter 1, I have begotten and brought up sons, but they rejected me. The ox knows its owner, and the donkey its master's crib. But Israel doesn't know me, and the people do not understand me. So he told him, the book of Isaiah, which is your book, because the Jews definitely believe in the Old Testament, say that the ox and the donkey are better than you. Definitely this irritated and frustrated the Jewish minister. So the Jewish minister, in response to this, said to the Khalifa, they have a verse in the Bible that says, if you have little faith, just like mustard seed, you can say to this mountain, move from here to there. So if they didn't move the mountain, then their book is wrong, and their faith is wrong, and all of them, they should either to convert or to be killed. Well, I'm telling you this story with all my respect to this Christian leader, but I don't think that the approach that he used was wise. And because he did not use a wise approach, that's why he brought this big trial and hardship on the Holy Church. And it is because of the love of God, and God covers multitude of our sins, and God actually is merciful, and God intervened and delivered the church from this big hardship. That's why St. Paul said, walk wisely. Walk wisely with those who are from outside. Walk in wisdom toward those who are outside. Number two, he said, redeeming the time. Redeeming the time. In his letter to Ephesians, St. Paul actually related the wisdom with redeeming the time. So St. Paul is saying here, one of the ways you present yourself as wise to those who are from outside, when you redeem your time. Redeeming, what does it mean to redeem your time? To use your time effectively. To use your time in what edifies. Not wasting your time in idle things, idle activities, or in actually destructive activities. So the people from outside, when they see that everything you do, you are doing it for the edification, for building up one another, for growing, for advancement, for progress, then they will perceive you that you are wise, and they will imitate your wisdom, and they will follow you because you are wise. So one of the things that we present our wisdom is to redeem the time. And also redeeming the time means what? Don't just be conformed to those who are from outside, to the non-Christian, and just spend time with them in nonsense and or actually in destructive activity or ungodly activities. No, you should redeem your time. Yes, we should walk with them wisely, but again, we shouldn't waste our time with them when they involve themselves in activities that are not beneficial and not constructive. Number three, he said, let your speech always be with grace. With grace. There is big difference between speaking gracefully and speaking judgmentally. You need to learn how to speak with grace. What does it mean to speak with grace? Grace is love. Grace is forgiveness. Grace is acceptance. Grace to be non-judgmental. That's grace. God spoke with grace with the woman that was caught in act. God spoke with grace with Zacchaeus. God spoke with grace with the man who was paralytic for 38 years. God spoke with grace with the Samaritan woman. But let me give you examples of judgmental talk. Simeon the Pharisee spoke judgmentally about the Lord Jesus Christ and about the sinful woman in his house. So there's a difference between speaking with grace or speaking judgmentally. In 2 Peter chapter 4 verse 11, St. Peter said, when you speak, speak according to the words of God. So speaking gracefully means you speak the word of God. See, when St. Mary visited Elizabeth, read the greetings, how they greeted one another. Elizabeth told her, blessed are you among women, blessed is the fruit of your womb. I'm unworthy even to have the mother of my Lord coming and visit me. This is a graceful greeting. Graceful greeting. So when you deal with those from outside, you need to speak with them, not judgmentally, not as we are better than you. No, with love, with acceptance. Yes, we judge the action, but not the person. But show them love and show them acceptance. That's what the Lord did with the Samaritan woman. He showed her love and acceptance, although he did not approve her action. And in this way, actually, she repented and returned back. Number four, he said, seasoned with salt. Your words should be seasoned with salt. When we add salt to food, why you add salt to food? Two important things. Number one, to give it taste, and number two, as preservative. That's the two main functions of the salt. In the same way, when we speak with salt, or our words are seasoned with salt, means when the people listen to what we say, you know, it will be acceptable, tasty for them, not offending them. The Lord Jesus Christ, when he spoke one-on-one, never offended anybody. Yeah, one time in his preaching, when he was preaching in general, he said, woe to you, woe to you, woe to you. But with the Pharisees, you know, when he spoke one-to-one, never offended anyone. Even Simeon, when he said, if this was a prophet, how the Lord approached him? He told him a story. There was a creditor who had two persons indebted to him. One owed him 50 dinar and the other one 500. And he forgave them both. Whom do you think will love him more? And when Simeon answered the Lord, he told him, you answered right. Your answer is right. That's graceful speech. That's taste. You know, he did not offend. He pointed out his mistake. Why? What he did. But actually, when he pointed him, he judges the action. You did not kiss me. You did not wash. He hears the Lord was speaking about his action. But he was very, very careful not to offend him. That's to give taste to your words. And also, your words not to destroy others, but to preserve them. Preservative, that's function of the soul. There's a big difference when you destroy a person with your word. When you use harsh words, some people, their words are sharper than the sword. It hurt, it destroys. But St. Paul is saying, no, let your words season to salt, to preserve. And actually in Ephesians he said, to give grace to the listeners. To give grace to the listeners. So that is, we should examine our words. Number one, to be accepted, tasty to the listener. Number two, to preserve them. The purpose, even when we admonish somebody, the purpose is not to destroy him or to punish him, but to preserve him. And finally, he said, that you may know how you ought to answer each one. What does it mean how you ought to answer each one? How you deal with everybody according to his own needs. You need to change your pattern and your style according to the need of the listener. For example, maybe you have 2 or 3 children, but how you deal with this maybe is different than this, is different than that, according to the need of each one. Like a clever physician, he does not prescribe the same medication for everybody, but actually he chooses the right medication for the right person. That's what St. Paul said, that you may know how you ought to answer each one. To answer this person is different than answering this person is different than answering this person. How to answer each one according to his needs. So St. Paul gave us 5 points how to deal with those from outside. Wisely, redeeming the time, speaking with grace, seasoned with salt, to give taste and also to be preservative, to preserve them. And number 5, according to the need of the listener. According to the need of the listener. Then from verse 7, St. Paul started to give his final greetings. He mentioned many people. The first two that he mentioned are Tychicus and Onesimus. Apparently, these two persons were the carriers of his letter. They carried his letter from Rome to Colossae. Tychicus was mentioned in Acts chapter 20 and verse 4, and also in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 22. And St. Paul described him with very, very beautiful words. He said about him, Tychicus, a beloved brother, faithful minister, fellow servant in the Lord. 3 wonderful descriptions. Beloved brother, faithful minister, fellow servant in the Lord. This shows us how St. Paul is genuine in his feeling toward those who are serving with him. He loved them. He considered them as not his children, but or students or disciples, but equal, brother, co-worker, fellow servant in the Lord. And actually, he praised their faithfulness and their ministry. And Onesimus, the other person, was the bond servant of Philemon, as we read in the letter to Philemon. But after he stole some money from Philemon and was in prison, apparently during this time he met with St. Paul, and St. Paul converted him to Christianity. That's why he spoke about him, that he gave birth to him in his chains, which means he gave birth to him in Christ. He was born again from Christ while St. Paul was in prison. And Onesimus started to serve with St. Paul, and apparently he sent him with this letter to with Tychicus to Colossae. Actually, their mission were 5 things. Number 1, to carry his letter to the people in Colossae and Laodicea. Number 2, to share with them the news about St. Paul. Because I'm sure people in Colossae were concerned about St. Paul. That's why he's sending these 2 persons in order to comfort their hearts and to share with them St. Paul's news in prison. Number 3, to share with them all what's happening in Rome. The news of the church in Rome and the persecution also in Rome. Share with them all what's happening in Rome. Number 4, to know their circumstances and to know their affairs What about, you know, the heresies like Gnosticism that was spreading in Clusi, whether it affected them or not? So St. Paul also as a father wanted to know their news and their circumstances. And by sharing this news, actually the hearts will be comforted. The heart will be comforted. It's important to share news. It's important that the servants communicate with their coordinators. The coordinators communicate with their priests. The priests communicate with their bishop. This communication comforts the heart and keeps the unity of the church, keep us all as one. And when we know the circumstances for another, we'll pray for one another and also will comfort one another. That's what he said. He said, Tychicus, a beloved brother, faithful minister, and fellow servant in the Lord, will tell you all the news about me. I am sending him to you for this very purpose, that he may know your circumstances and comfort your hearts. With Onesimus, again he described Onesimus with wonderful description here, a faithful and beloved brother. Although he was the son of St. Paul, not biological son, but spiritual son, because he converted to Christianity at the hand of St. Paul. But see here how St. Paul described him as brother, faithful and beloved brother. And he was a servant also, was a slave. But يعني في فليمون يقول الذي ولدته في قيودي. So he was his son, a spiritual son, but now he is describing him as a beloved brother. Who is one of you, because Philemon was living actually in Clusi. And Onesimus, the bond servant of Philemon, was living also in Clusi. That's why he said, who is one of you. They will make known to you all things which are happening here, happening in Rome. So the 5 points to carry the letter, to share with them the news of St. Paul, to tell them about what's happening in Rome, to know their circumstances, and to comfort their hearts. After this, St. Paul mentioned 3 Jewish fellow workers. 3 Jewish fellow workers. Aristarchus, and Aristarchus was mentioned in Acts chapter 19, verse 29. Saint Mark, who is Barnabas' nephew, but here it's written as cousin. You know, usually people say, you know, about the nephew, can call him cousin if they are, you know, close in age or something like this. And about a third person also who is from Jewish background, his name actually was Jesus. But after the ascension of the Lord Jesus Christ, the people felt it is not proper to keep the name Jesus, to be named for, you know, their people, just human being. And they want to keep this name Jesus for the Lord Jesus Christ. That's why they start to take other names. So this Jesus is called now Justus. So this is the name that he took in order not to use the word Jesus. And St. Paul said these 3 persons were comfort to him during the time of his imprisonment in Rome. They comforted him. They actually attended to his needs. They visited him. They helped him during this hard time. And it's interesting when you read the description about St. Mark here. I'm sure all of you are aware of the tensions that happened between St. Paul and St. Mark in the second missionary trip, and how St. Paul refused to take St. Mark with him. But now, this tension is over, and St. Paul actually is describing St. Mark with a very, very beautiful description. And actually he is sending instruction to the Clusians about St. Mark. which gives us a lesson. Sometimes when there is a tension happen between two servants or whatever, it may take years and years and years to be resolved, if it ever resolved. But here the situation is totally different. Yes, there was a tension, but now it's resolved. And actually, St. Paul, in his letter to Timothy, he spoke very, very highly about St. Mark and how he is beneficial to St. Paul in his ministry. Let's read these verses from verse 10. Aristarchus, my fellow prisoner. Aristarchus was imprisoned with St. Paul in Rome. Some people, they say it was willingly, and Aristarchus chose to remain with St. Paul in his prison, because the first imprisonment in Rome was like house arrest. When you read in the last chapter of Book of Acts, we read that St. Paul took a house and stayed in it 2 years. That was actually the first imprisonment. So it was like a house arrest. He stayed in this house and he was in chains with a soldier guarding him. And people chose to stay with St. Paul under this house arrest, you know, in his house. Like, if you remember when Pope Shenouda was in the monastery, you know, all the monks actually were in the monastery with him. They cannot leave, they cannot go. So some people actually chose willingly to be with St. Paul in this house arrest. Aristarchus, my fellow prisoner, greets you. With Mark, the cousin of Barnabas. Actually, was the nephew of Barnabas. وفي العربي مكتوب ابن اخت برنابا، بس هنا في الانجليزي مكتوب the cousin of Barnabas. About whom you received instruction. So he sent instruction to the Colossians about St. Mark. If he comes to you, welcome him. Welcome him. So again, he is instructing them to receive him with love and to welcome him. And Jesus, who is called Justice. These are my only fellow workers for the kingdom of God, who are of the circumcision, from Jewish background, of circumcision from Jewish background. So the only three from the Jews that attended to the needs of St. Paul in his first imprisonment in Rome was Aristarchus, Mark, and Justice. That's why he called them my fellow workers for the kingdom of God. Our goal is to preach the kingdom of God. They have proved to be a comfort to me. They have proved to be a comfort to me. And here just, I'm going to ask a question for you to think about it. Are we source of comfort to our spiritual fathers, like these people were source of comfort to St. Paul, or are spiritual a source of trouble to our spiritual fathers? Just a thought to think about it. Because St. Paul here, he said, they have proved to be a comfort to me. They have proved to be a comfort to me. So he mentioned the two carriers of the letter, Tychicus and Onesimus. Then he spoke about the three Jewish fellow workers, Aristarchus, Mark, and Justus. Then he spoke about Epaphras. If you remember, who is Epaphras? Epaphras is the one who preached Christianity in Colossae. He was the bishop of Colossae. And St. Paul actually spoke about him very, very highly, because he was very, very zealous in his ministry. St. Paul said, because he was from Colossae originally, Epaphras was from Colossae. So he told them, he is from you, he was their bishop, and he described him as a bond servant of Christ. He said about him, laboring fervently for them in prayer to be perfect and complete in all the will of God. And the description of Epaphras here is actually a description of the faithful servant. So if I am servant I should examine myself with against Epaphras. Epaphras was laboring fervently in prayer. Do we labor fervently in prayer for our children and our classes and our flock and our people or not? He is laboring fervently. It means in his prayer, he is struggling with God. He is praying with passion, consistently, fervently, laboring fervently. Why? In order to be perfect and complete in all the will of God, not in a part of it, but in every aspect, to fulfill the will of God in every aspect in their life. And then St. Paul said, I testify that he has a great zeal. Some people, they serve with zeal. You feel their passion in the service. And some people, they just they do the service routinely. They're very lukewarm. There is no spirit, there is no zeal, there is no passion. You need to put all your heart to have this zeal when you serve in God. Actually, in Jeremiah it said, cursed is he who is doing the service of the Lord lukewarmly. مَلْعُونَ أَنْ يَعْمَلْ عَمَلَ الرَّبَّ بْرَخَاوَةً. If you are called to serve the Lord, you need to have passion to labor fervently for the ministry of God. Listen to what St. Paul said about Epaphras, starting from verse 11. The 12. Epaphras is the bishop of Colossae who preached Christianity to the Colossians, who is one of you because he is from Colossae originally, a bond servant of Christ. Bond servant means in complete submission to Christ, in complete submission to the will of God, a bond servant of Christ, greets you, always laboring fervently for you in prayer, that you may stand perfect and complete. That's his desire, the desire of a zealous servant, that his people may be perfect and complete in all the will of God, in all the will of God. For I bear him witness. Now there's a testimony that he has a great zeal for you and those who are in Laodicea and those in Hierapolis. So these three cities, Colossae, Laodicea, and Hierapolis, were like the diocese of Epaphras. And St. Paul is saying that he has a great zeal for these the people in these three cities. Then he spoke about Luke and Demas. Luke, the beloved physician, and Demas greet you. He described Luke as beloved, and as you know, Luke was a physician. So he said, the beloved physician. But Demas, he didn't mention a word about him. Not a single word about him. Because as he said in 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 10, that Demas left him because he loved the contemporary world. So apparently, St. Paul at that time started to feel that Demas, his heart is not like before. His heart is getting lukewarm. That's why he didn't say a word about Demas. And this shows us that St. Paul was not just complimenting people like in hypocrisy, in hypocrisy. No. Actually, he was describing people honestly. He didn't feel anything about Demas because Demas started to drift away. That's why he just mentioned Demas. But every other person he mentioned, he said, the beloved physician, you know, he is a faithful minister, has a great zeal. Usually, he was genuine in his description about other people, but Demas, he did not mention a single word about him. Then, verse 15, he told them, greet the brethren who are in Laodicea. After he sent the greeting from people who are with him, now he is greeting the people in Colossae and Laodicea. Laodicea was another city, as I told you, Laodicea, Hierapolis, and Colossae. And the people used to meet in a house of a person from Laodicea called Nymphas. That's why he said, greet the brethren who are in Laodicea and Nymphas and the church that is in his house. So Nymphas made his house a church. And actually the houses of the believers should be houses of God. And we should have like, you know, prayer corners in our houses. The name of God should be praised, and we have to have the family altar in our houses. Then from verse 16, he is saying his final remarks to this letter. Now when this epistle is read among you, see that it is read also in the church of the Laodiceans. So he told them, when you read this letter in Colossae, make sure to take the letter and read it also in Laodicea. And that you likewise read the epistle from the Laodicea. All or most of the scholars of the Bible say the letter from Laodicea is the letter of St. Paul to Ephesus. That's the letter from Laodicea. So it's telling them, this letter should be read in your church, and the second letter, my letter to you, should be read in Laodicea. And as I said in the first lecture, the letter of Ephesus and the letter of Colossae are very, very similar to each other. But Ephesus is focusing on the church, the body of Christ. Colossae is focusing on Christ, the head of the church. So they are complementing one another. One focusing on Christ, the head of the church, and the other church, the body of Christ. Verse 17, and say to Archippus. Archippus, many scholars say he is the son of Philemon. As I told you, Philemon was living in Colossae with his wife Epiphaia and his son Archippus. Apparently, Archippus started to be a little bit lukewarm. That's why St. Paul is sending this message to him and actually asking the whole church to remind him with this message. Because we have responsibility to one another to hold each other accountable. So he told them, say to Archippus, take heed to the ministry which you have received it in the Lord, that you may fulfill it. And in this message, actually there are many lessons. Number one, it is God who gives us the ministry. Number two, we need to fulfill the ministry. Number three, actually, we need to pay attention and to be watchful and vigilant in order to fulfill the ministry. So, every servant in any capacity, this message to Archippus should be message to each one of us. Take heed to the ministry which you have received in the Lord that you may fulfill it. It is God who gives you this ministry. You need to take heed to this ministry in order to fulfill it. And then, when you give account before God in the last day, you say to him, the talent that you give me, now I made profit with this talent. St. Paul, in all his letters, he used somebody to dictate the letter and somebody write it for him. Then St. Paul just puts the last signature. And now St. Paul had chains in his hands. So actually he is signing the letter with his chains. That's why he said, the salutation by my own hand, Paul. So this is my signature. And why he signed it, in order to be authentic. But while he was writing, definitely he's writing with chains, so his writing was not, he was not comfortable in signing the letter. That's why he said, remember my chains. Remember my chains. The salutation by my own hand, Paul, remember my chains. And he gives them the final benediction. Grace be with you. Amen. That's his final benediction to the people in Colossae. Glory be to God forever and ever. Amen.